EVAR has been very controversial in the last 12 months. There have been some controversial guidelines that we'll discuss, and there have been many other issues that are very topical at the moment. And a forum of a big meeting such as CIRSE and the Ideas Symposium is ideal to discuss these issues. We have known for some time that EVAR is associated with a lower early or short-term mortality, and that it's a minimally invasive procedure that's very appealing to patients.
EVAR is not a standalone technique anymore. EVAR has evolved towards fenestrated EVAR and branched EVAR. That means that we can now treat many more patients with endovascular techniques. But we need to respect the limitations of each technique. If we only talk about standard EVAR, the most important limitation is the need to have a decent proximal neck.
Only about 50% of patients have anatomy suitable for conventional EVAR. The most common limitation is the so-called hostile neck, but there are other issues like iliac access or iliac aneurysms.
It is extremely important to look into all the options for each individual patient. There may be patients that will do much better with an open repair. There may be patients that would still need an EVAR with adjunctive techniques. And there may even be patients where we say that the risk of rupture is low, so that we prefer not to embark on a tedious, risky technique that has no durability in favor of conservative treatment.
The EVAR field is continuously developing. There is a number of new technology coming into the market, new stents and new techniques. Despite the very good short-term results that come with EVAR in terms of the low 30-day mortality, early mobilization and short hospital stay, as well as the minimal invasiveness, which is now getting better with the lower profile devices coming into the market, there is a substantial problem that appears on the mid and long term, which is the reintervention rate and delayed rupture. The NICE guidelines related to EVAR, which I need to make myself clear is still in the draft phase, has based their analysis on the data created from randomized controlled trials done 10 or 15 years ago. And this data is a credible one and should be analyzed. However, making recommendations is a different matter.
The NICE guidelines have obviously caused a lot of controversy, particularly in the group of patients who are not fit for open surgery but could be managed by EVAR. And I think given the reaction, we're going to have to see some modification of the guidelines to allow treatment for some of these patients.
I see the NICE guidelines as a warning. We have to stick to the rules and document our treatment algorithm. That is very important.
The other issue with the NICE guidelines or the recommendations of the guidelines, they block the door for any innovation in the future. There is no support for this continuously developing field, which relies heavily on technology as well as on experience of the operators.
Ideally, we'd like to see ongoing development of both the EVAR devices and some ancillary techniques to deal with some of the problems that really threaten durability of these current devices, and then make it a much more durable solution analogous to open repair, ultimately, hopefully, to avoid the need for ongoing surveillance.